bit nervous even, so forgive me if I, I don't know, get a little... Yeah, anyway, so my name is Suzanne Rothman. I am a Fulbright English teaching assistant here. I'm based at the Azerbaijan State University of Economics. Does anyone here study there? Okay, that's okay. So I've been in Azerbaijan for about 3 months. I really like it so far. It's been great. First of all, before I begin, I just wanted to thank the U.S. Embassy and the American Corner for setting this up. This is such an exciting opportunity because, the first biggest reason that I came to Azerbaijan was for cultural exchange, because it's so rare for Americans and Azeris to meet. So I'm really glad I have the opportunity to meet all of you and tell you a little bit about something I really love about American culture. And I also hope to learn a little from you. So first and foremost, I'm an English teacher. So I might stop and ask you what you think about things and stuff like that. So don't be intimidated to answer or anything, please. Also, feel free to raise your hand at any point if something I say isn't clear, or if you have a question about anything I said, or if I'm talking too fast, just say, well, I'm slow down, because I do that. I get excited and I start talking really quickly. So feel free to tell me to slow down. And with that, without any further ado, I'd like to begin talking about our topic today.
Okay. Yeah. Do you want to say the university?
Oh, hello.
There. Yes, and we are going to have candidates.
Okay, fantastic. All right then. So today's topic is country music. My presentation. Okay, great. I'd like to tell you all that in college I studied Islamic and Middle Eastern studies, so I am by no means an expert on this topic. I'm just going to tell you a little bit about it, about the history, where it came from, who the major artists are, and that sort of thing. So it's not, like I said, not an expert. I might not have an answer to all of your questions, but hopefully I can help you gain a little bit of insight into country music. Okay, so what is country music, first of all? It's a very uniquely American genre of music. It was originally developed in the United States, and it's really kind of only, it only exists there. I haven't heard of artists from any other country performing this style of music. And for a lot of people in other countries, I've heard that this style is very emblematic or symbolic of American life. And we're going to talk a little bit about why that is. So first of all, the origin of country music. It began in the early days of the United States when immigrants from what is today the United Kingdom, from England, met with immigrants from other countries, other European countries, and Africa as well. And so their music, what was called British Isle folk music, meshed with other musical styles. And this was happening mainly in the south of the United States. It's attributed particularly to the Appalachian Mountains. So in this map over here, you can see where the mountain range goes. And so the development was happening mainly here in the southern part of this mountain range. And these pictures here just depict what the view there looks like, so what people there, what they were experiencing, what they were seeing. So this is part of their experience. And this was called in the 1800s. And originally, back in those days, the music was not referred to as country, but as old-time music. That's what they called it. that were being used, that this music was truly a combination, a mesh of different styles of music from different parts of the world. And now to me, this is why this music is so incredibly American, because America is all about people from different cultures, different backgrounds, different experiences, coming together and creating something new. And part of that something new is culture. And this is why I think country music is so incredibly American. Now, country began to be popular in the 1920s. This happened in concurrence with when records, or what is today CDs, and radio were beginning to become popular in the United States. And so the first ever country recording in history is attributed to these two gentlemen, Eck Robertson and Henry Gilliland. So they were both from the South, and they met at a Confederate soldiers reunion. Do you guys know what Confederate soldiers are? Have you ever heard this term? You heard?
Yeah, what was the Confederate Army?
Right, yeah, and what was the Confederate Army? Right. In the Civil War, there was a Civil War in the United States, and the North and the South were fighting each other, and the Southern Army was known as the Confederate Army. So these two guys met at one of the reunions, and they started making music together, and eventually they got to record a track in 1922. And now, to kind of give you a taste of what that old-time music, origin of country sounded like, I'd like to play this clip. Can someone, is there some tech person?
Yes, we are.
It's good.
Popular, people in the north, the record company executives, people who were deciding who gets to record and who doesn't, were not very friendly to this kind of music. They thought it was not the highest form of art. They disrespected it. They thought it was music that was made only by hillbillies. Have you guys ever heard that term, hillbilly? Well, it's a derogatory or insulting term for people from Appalachia or the South who people would consider them to be ignorant and less smart than everyone else. So so these people from the North were kind of thinking of country artists as being not real artists, I suppose. But still, despite what these people thought, this music sold because people liked it. And so one of the first songs to become a hit was a song called Little Old Log Cabin in the Lane by this guy, Goodwin Johnny Carson. And so yeah, I'd like to play you a little bit of that song. That was a big success in the United States. It was a folk song, so it's not... a lot of country songs are songs that the lyrics of were, you know, are folk lyrics. We don't know who wrote them, but different artists have recorded different versions of them over the years. So this is one of those songs. That sound.
sorry. Bad you romance, 15 years ago today.
And the most famous Roy Rogers, who's in this clip. Yeah, what better than to share it for yourself?
These guys, first of all, are probably the most famous group.
Yeah, Johnny Cash. Yeah, that's Johnny Cash, right? Everyone knows him. Next to him is Willie Nelson. That's Chris Christopherson. And over on that side is Waylon Jennings. Anyway, so this genre kind of emerged in the late 1960s and became more popular in the 70s. And it began because the record executives in Nashville were kind of moving the sound away from its rugged, rough, honky-tonk roots, so what we talked about earlier, and they were trying to make the sound softer, more pop-like. And some artists went along with that, but a couple of them, especially Waylon Jennings and Willie Nelson, were not down with that at all. They wanted to do their own thing. They wanted to stay loyal to what country really was, to its sounds, to the fact that the songs are folk songs, and they wanted to continue storytelling through music. And so they refused to succumb to what the executives, or the suits as we call them, were telling them to do. And both of them pushed through a lot of the criticism in order to produce their own records. And despite what the record executives thought, people really loved it. And so the management, they saw that there was a market, and so there's a very famous record produced, including Willie Nelson and Waylon Jennings, called Wanted, the Outlaws. And that album was the first country album in history to sell over 1 million records. And this was in the 70s, so that's really huge, and arguably what really put country on the map as mainstream American music. And so what I want to play for you to kind of give you a sense of what this movement was is a performance by Cash, Nelson, Jennings, and Christopherson, who, like I said, the most famous group of outlaws. And I want you to pay attention in the song, go to in the beginning what they're doing in the opening, and also what they're singing about. We're going to talk about that a little. Thank you. hold on to whatever thoughts you had about this.
Later, he also served in the U.S.
U.S. Air Force, and when he came back, he began his artistic career. And through his artistic career as well, he struggled a lot. He struggled with some of the problems that come with fame, temptations, and he became addicted to drugs for a while, but he was able to overcome his addiction. Although that was also a big influence on the kind of music he made, and it also enabled him to have compassion for those people in society who usually really do not get our compassion. He was very much involved with prisoners. Do you guys know anything about what he did regarding that issue? Okay, yeah. In a way, yeah.
So they all had a policy that connected policy that ties to other parts.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think we have to.
Right, yeah. Mm-hmm. Because of his own experiences, he had a few run-ins with the law himself. He understood that everyone has a story. And while, you know, he never advocated for prisoners to be set free or anything like that, you know, you do the crime, you do the time, but he also felt like, you know, we should have compassion for these people. And so he made a custom out of performing in prisons. He was the first artist to ever do that. This was in 1957. He began to perform in state prisons to show that these people are not forgotten about, and that, you know, they can get redemption, they can get a second chance. And so the clip I have for you guys is of him performing a song he wrote about Folsom Prison. Oh, we'll go back to that. We'll go back to that later. Yeah. So this song is not this song. It's called Folsom Prison Blues. It was written about Folsom Prison, but it was performed in a different prison, San Quentin. So this is it.
Yeah. And all of the music is very dynamic.
Mm-hmm.
And I think
showing that everyone has a story, right, no matter who they are. And I think part of that also came from the fact that he was a very religious man. He was a Christian, and he was a very big believer, and I think that's where a lot of his compassion also came from. In addition to having had some difficulties with the law himself, he was actually sued by the U.S. government for burning down a forest at one time. It was an accident, but yeah. So that's the kind of guy he was. And he was really a man of the people. I strongly recommend that you listen to one of his concerts, especially the ones at the prisons. He's hilarious. You know, he loves to joke with people. He would really break the barriers a lot between the audience and the performer, which is also something that is very typical of country music. The artists are, you know, they consider themselves to be part of the people, not above. You know, there's an equality between the entertainer and the entertained. Okay. So, United States. So I'm going to skip ahead a little to what is country music today. So today it's become really a mixed bag. All these people that you see here are all pretty different from one another, are all considered country artists, like including Taylor Swift. I'm sure you guys all know who she is. And Lady Antebellum, this group, I imagine you've heard about them. So there are people, so Taylor Swift and other artists like her are very influenced by pop music, so they're really in a class of their own, which is country pop, and while she's doing that, there are some artists that have still been working to maintain the integrity of hardcore country. This gentleman over here, George Strait, he still very much plays in that honky-tonk style that we heard earlier. He's still very loyal to that. And I would argue that Tim McGraw, has anyone heard of him? He's very famous in the US. I wonder if people know him. No, okay, maybe it's just an American thing. Alright, yeah, so there are very diverse styles, but country is still very, very much mainstream, extremely popular. In fact, there's an entire channel on cable dedicated to this kind of music, playing music videos and interviews and what have you. There's also an award show, the Country Music Awards, in which all these artists are featured, and I actually have a clip. I wanted to do a little comparison. So the first one is George Strait, the guy who, as I said, is still in that old hardcore style.
Thank you.
holding on to the old traditions, and then this little so this next one is a collaboration between Tim McGraw and Taylor Swift, which was voted the country event of the year at the CMAs. They actually happened, and that was just a few weeks ago. So this is something very, very recent, of showing a little what's mainstream popular country today.